Welcome, everyone, to the Sports Illustrated Media Podcast. I'm your host, Jimmy Trina. Thank you for listening. Great show this week. We've got Roman Reigns from the WWE, the Universal Champion, in an outstanding interview where he talks about Vince McMahon recently retiring, what that means for him, get into his new reduced schedule, whether he's going to face The Rock at WrestleMania. So any WWE fan will be interested in that interview with Roman. He was tremendous following Roman. Great spot with Andy Staples, who covers college football for The Athletic. Discussed the Big Ten media deal, what that means, the ramifications for college football fans, Pac-12, how that's impacted, USC and UCLA leaving and going to the Big Ten. Get into all of that, a little taste of what's coming up this season as well. So check that out if you're a college football fan. Before we get to it, last week, Tim Burke, a.k.a. Bubba Prague from Twitter, was on the podcast talking about the Manti Te'o doc, which he broke the big story at Deadspin years ago. Linda Cohen, Brian Gerwertz, former WWE head writer, on the pod 2 weeks ago. So check those out in the archives if you haven't listened. And leave a review on Apple, and we will read it here on the podcast sometime soon. All right, let's get to it. Roman Reigns, followed by Andy Staples, right here on the SI Media Podcast. All right, joining me now, always love talking to this guy, SI Media Podcast regular and the WWE Universal Champion, Roman Reigns. I will acknowledge you. How are you?
That's a good way to start. I'm pretty good, Jimmy. How you doing, man?
I'm doing well. How about you? Everything good on your end?
No complaints. Not yet. Yeah. Not yet.
Roman's got a big pay-per-view match coming up against Drew McIntyre, Clash at the Castle on WWE Network on Peacock in Cardiff. You excited about traveling for the trip?
Yeah. I mean, it'll be a quick trip. You know, I try to keep everything tight, especially with the road nowadays. So it'll be probably like one of those 18-hour trips, get in, you know, late the night before, get a little bit of sleep, and then hit the ground running Saturday. Smash Drew, jump back on the jet, back home, man. Easy.
Yep. I should mention it. The pay-per-view is on Saturday, September 3rd, WWE Network, Peacock, at 1 in the afternoon Eastern because of the time difference, Roman against Drew McIntyre, Clash of the Castle. Since you mentioned it, let's start there because it's something I've wanted to talk to you about for a little while now, because there are all these reports, internet rumors, speculation about the Roman Reigns schedule. Well, let's start with this. You signed a new deal with WWE this year?
Yeah.
Okay. Can you tell us how many years, or do we keep that a secret?
I don't really like to get into specifics, especially like we're you know, timelines. There's different ways to play with these things.
Gotcha. So, all right, but I will ask specifics about the schedule, because there's supposedly a scaled back, reduced schedule for you. What can you tell us about your schedule going forward as the top dog in the WWE?
I think the main thing is you know, when you've been on the road for almost 10 years straight, and someone who's been kind of, you know, at the highest level, you know, the main event level, you know, I ran a full schedule for a long time. And even before we went to Fox, and it changed to where it was, you know, SmackDown on Friday, then we do two live events Saturday, Sunday. And then there was the occasional Monday Night Raw. So that's a 4-night schedule, which still isn't as bad as what it used to be. I mean, we used to do Friday, Saturday, Sunday live events, Monday Night Raw, then we would tape SmackDown Tuesday. So we were only getting a day and a half because, you know, we fly out, you know, this is before private travel and buses and all that stuff. So we would fly out Wednesday morning, get home. So you get half of Wednesday, you get home and you're beat, you're tired. You got half of that Wednesday, then you got your Thursday to just try to handle personal life and family and everything that comes with that. And then you're back out Friday. So for me, it was really just trying to balance everything. And, you know, someone who has 5 children, you know, we're in a very critical portion of their lives where they're so young, and they this is where we build these relationships and these bonds, and they get to know who their dad is. So for me, it was extremely important that I can build, you know, my fatherhood as the priority and the number one hat that I wear. And WWE, Vince, you know, everybody was really good about accommodating that and making sure to keep me in the WWE family.
So will we see you less on pay-per-views, or will it be more like you'll be less on house shows, less on SmackDown, a little mixture of it? What are we going to...
Okay, yeah, I didn't really answer the question there, did I?
You did a good job. Listen, you did. I appreciate the attempt.
Molded around that thing.
I appreciate
good,
the attempt.
So the main thing is we're not going to be on every single pay per view, but anything that I am on, which will be, of course, all the major ones, and then a couple of the other ones, that fall kind of in between the big four and the Saudis. I'll always support those with TVs to build the story and the rivalry going forward. So it's not like, compared to what I did, I guess, yeah, technically you could say it's compared to a full time on everything. You only get a day and a half a week. Yeah, I guess it's a part time compared to what I've usually run. But I mean, I'm an annual character on WWE television.
And I certainly wouldn't use the word part time. I mean, even with this, you're still far from part time. It's just, I think reduced is really the word for it. I'm just curious, does it concern you in any way in terms of storylines, building hype for a pay-per-view that maybe you're not around as much? Is it, or do you think you can get your point across in fewer appearances, build it, make money, do the pay-per-views? What about from the actual business standpoint of it for you?
Now, I think it's actually done well so far, and the reactions, it makes everything feel a little more special if you're not, as obtainable, if you're not as available. I think it kind of puts a little mystique around you. So, pretty much all the houses have done very well. The actual reaction, the decibel level is still very high. I couldn't have really planned for it to go any better, and hopefully we'll just continue to build that. But for me, I've done it where I can do it every single week. That's no problem for me. But at the same time, if your quality's high, the quantity doesn't have to be crazy,
Yeah. I think you and I may have discussed this once before, but one of the weirder things about the wrestling business is that a guy like yourself, who's the top guy, there's the one hand where you want to be on every week because you are the top guy and get the rating and sell the merch and build the storylines. And then the flip side of that is, I think it's so helpful in wrestling when someone goes away for a little bit and comes back. I mean, you experienced that yourself, not for reasons that were, you were sick one time and another time I think you just stayed away maybe at the beginning. But it is weird that you want to be there every week and it helps so much to not be there sometimes and take a break. Would you agree with that, or am I off on that?
No, I think, these are things and feelings I've felt, even within this new contract in the past few months and having that, that almost that micromanaging complex, where like I need to be in control and I should be doing more. And, you feel like you can't help from the sideline or something like that, when that's not the case. I think that's more of like a mental, type of thing that, any performer would go through, that, oh, I'm not there and, I'm being forgotten, or I'm not helping, or, you feel like you're not, carrying the same weight that you used to, maybe. But at the end of the day, there's no off season. I am just a human. So we have to take all these things into account. You want to stay in Superman mode and you want to be on everything. You want to, help the product as much as you can, help the merchandising as much as you can, and satisfy the consumer. But if you spread yourself too thin, it goes both ways. So yeah, it's really about finding, that kind of that mental safe, that very safe place for yourself, to where you're not blowing your brain up and being, anxious or having anxiety about it, but at the same time, just trusting it and going with the flow.
It's funny because I don't think you did Money in the Bank this past year. So when I saw you were doing the Clash at the Castle on Saturday, September 3rd, 1:00, WWE Network on Peacock against Drew McIntyre, I was like, that's in it. I would have thought maybe that would get skipped. Did they have to like twist your arm to go overseas, or is overseas such a big deal for WWE that you knew you had to do that one coming up?
Well, the strategy for the first few months after Mania was to be on you know, Money in the Bank. But once the show was changed and it was moved away from the Allegiant Stadium into the arena, we've re-strategized and we've just kind of stayed on the path of hitting these huge ones, you know, going into the winter. So once Money in the Bank was moved, they pulled, I was pulled from that, and we knew that we're going to hit SummerSlam, and then also Cardiff being a huge stadium show as well, being an international show. It was just, I knew I was going to be a part of that one. Yeah. So for me, it wasn't a surprise. Once I knew things were up with Money in the Bank, I figured there was going to be an adjustment there.
Gotcha. Last one on the schedule. So you're home a little bit more now. You mentioned you have five kids. Your kids are all young, two sets of twins. Are you having those days where you're home and you're like, might be better off on the road right here? You know, the fighting starts, the mess, the spilled milk, the spilled, you know, mac and cheese, the who's fighting over the iPad. And it's like, you know what, it wouldn't be so bad being in an arena right now.
We got all that going. Everything you just named and more. It's funny. You hit off so many. Spilled mac and cheese, tablets, all the whole nine. It's crazy here. But this past weekend up in Canada, I did Montreal, and then the next day we were in Ottawa. So it was just a quick little bus right there. But I was sitting in the bus Saturday morning and I was just like, man, it's so quiet. It's almost disturbing how quiet it is in here. And I'm so used to it. I have a loud house, man. It's crazy. Yeah, yeah. They literally just went down for naps. And then the big boys and my daughter, they're at school right now. So this is the most quiet the house gets.
But right. You're in Florida where they start school early there. I'm in New York. So yeah. Here no one starts school. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Thank God for school, right?
Yeah, it's opened it up. But I mean, I have such a structure and a system of what my day looks like. And you know, between my training and nutrition, I mean, that's a full-time job in its own right. So I keep my day pretty plugged, you know, plugged in to stay on schedule and do all my little things and take care of all my little tasks.
Does every kid have their own tablet?
No, so
these people that say it's bad to parent with the tablet, bullshit. Give the kids the tablet. Give them the tablet. Give them the tablet.
There's times where you're like, where is that thing? Give it to them, so they'll shut up, right? No, so it's funny because we're going through that now. So the big boys have the tablets, but when they're at school, they don't have. Right. They stay at home. So the babies find the tablets and they think it's theirs all day long, until the big boys get back, and it's just a snatch. And then as soon as that happens, it's a meltdown. They're crying.
And I'll tell you the problem you're going to have too when the girls get older and then they all have them, because then they fight over the chargers, and if a charger breaks or a charger gets lost, then the chargers are a big issue too. So
Jimmy,
be ready.
I bought at least 20 of those, just the bases alone. I mean, I bought so many chargers. Those guys have destroyed. I've spent probably $200 on Amazon just getting chargers and plugs and things like that.
I know
that's
crazy.
Feeling.
I'm glad to see someone in your position is in the same boat as me, and I'm sure their listeners like that too. Tell me about, let's switch gears here, because you mentioned a couple of times, I didn't plan on asking this, but I'm just curious, because you mentioned a couple of times riding the bus. About how many superstars, I guess we can call them wrestlers now, which we'll get into later. How many people have the bus now? How many people are riding their own personal bus in WWE? Was Cena the first? Was that, or am I wrong on that?
No, I think Triple H and Undertaker were the first.
Okay.
I feel like Triple H told me that before years ago. Right. And the main thing was just because, you know, he was starting to have his daughters and everything. And you know, obviously with Steph being, you know, a part of a huge part of the company now, even more so, they were always on the road there together. So that was just a kind of an amenity to help them travel their kids and keep some normalcy. But yeah, there's been a handful. When I first got on the road, there were a bunch of them. And then it kind of slowed down, and it was just still John and Randy, I think, and maybe Big Show for a little bit. And then it just kind of was Randy for a little while until I got into one. And then now it's kind of multiplied. So we probably have like anywhere from 5 to 6 different people who have buses.
Now, do you let people ride the bus if they want, or is it strict just you, Heyman, maybe the Usa or other stragglers?
Yeah, Bloodline only. Yeah.
Well, no stragglers.
Yeah, no, but nobody. Yeah. I mean, unless if you're a part of my creative process, then you can come on the bus. But most likely, we keep that thing locked up.
Do you have like the same driver, or is there like a rotation with drivers?
Nah, man, Charlie. Yes, sir.
Charlie.
Yeah, that's my guy.
Do you know, I'd love to know if Charlie, when, at the peak, let's say a month ago or 2 months ago when the gas was over $5, what it cost to fill up the bus?
I'd have to go back and look at the logs. Okay. Yeah.
Just curious.
It's expensive. It's not cheap.
Give me, last question on this. Give me like the coolest thing on the bus or about the bus. Is there something that you're like, yeah, this is pretty dope that I get to have this on the bus or do this on the bus or something like that?
You just have to see it. The whole, I mean, it's just,
have we ever seen the bus? Has there ever been video of the bus anyway? Have you ever taken us?
I may have done like an interview, but it's kind of in this type of, you know, framing. Right. I mean, we got a fireplace on that thing.
There you go.
There's probably like six TVs inside of it. There's one outside with a whole barbecue setup. I mean, I can play PlayStation while driving, you know, connected to the Wi-Fi and all that stuff. So it's pretty nice. I think the coolest part is the king size bed in it, though. That's the best.
I like the fireplace, king size. Yeah, I mean, listen, I know you're not a huge social media guy, but pictures and video of the bus would be nice if you could do that one day for us. We want to see the bus.
Maybe once we're getting closer to not using it anymore, upgrading, you know, switching it up, maybe. But
yeah. Right. Speaking of switching it up, we alluded to it. Obviously, you can't talk about the WWE without mentioning the fact that Vince McMahon just retired over some controversy. Two questions for you on it. The first is just your first reaction when you heard Vince was retiring. I know he sent out a tweet, and I think there was subsequently a press release. Love to know how you found out, your initial reaction, and then I'll have a second part when you're done with that, and then we'll move on.
It was just hard to believe, you know, because I think along with anyone who's followed this business or been in this business, they just, Vince is going to be running this. I'm going to be long gone. You know, I'll be 20 years retired and Vince is still running the show. You know what I mean? So I think that was just kind of, we'll see. We'll see in 6 months or something like that. Like, I think was kind of the mindset that I initially took. And then I think I received the talent relations text message. And then obviously a personal message from him. And, you know, we talked a little bit and,
I'm curious when that happened and when anything really wild and crazy happens in the world of wrestling, the fans and even media people like myself, there's always, the first wave is always, is this real? This isn't real. Do the wrestlers do with something this big, were the wrestlers sort of like, is this real? Is this not real? Or did you know, because you know, you're in the company, that it was legit?
No, I mean, until I'm hearing from either Paul or higher, I believe everything's a work. I just say, oh, they're trying to get an angle on it, you know, and I'm not going to be the one that believes it. And then you got me, and then, no, I work too. Right. So I just, it's all a work to me. Nothing's real until like I'm counting it. So, yeah.
It's funny how that's become part of everyday life. And especially it became a huge part of politics when Trump jumped into just, because now anything that happens outside of wrestling, everyone's, is it a work? Is it a work? It's amazing that it's become such a staple of real life. The second and last question I had about Vince, obviously you've had this massively successful run with Vince at the helm. I'm sorry I didn't do the research, but I know you've held the title for like over 700 days in a row now, I believe it is.
It's over seven.
Yeah. So you've become the face of the company. You've sold a ton of merch. You've made a lot of money. Now he's gone. Paul Levesque, Triple H, Stephanie running things. Is there trepidation? Is it, are we going to continue this? Is it, I got to prove myself to Paul Levesque? What's for you, your own personal character and then business of it? What do you go through with the change at the top?
It's, you know, we can't just, we're not erasing what I've done. You know what I mean? So I think, it's very visible, even if Paul, wasn't completely locked into what we've been doing over the past 6 months. And obviously over the past year with the health issues that he's overcome and everything, you know, and the journey that he's been on. But, you know, we never forget, you know, what we've done and the body of work that we have and why we're to the point that we are. But I think, you know, like anyone that's trying to get better or progress, they're going to keep that mindset that, you know, I'm constantly trying to better myself. You know, this week is an audition for next week. And that's how I look at it. I mean, I literally, it was funny because I just did that house show in Ottawa, and one of the producers, after we were done, you know, they come up to me and they, man, you bump like you're auditioning for a job. And, you know, I don't do anything crazy. You know, we didn't do any crazy, you know, right, bumps or anything, but it was just my regular old flatbacks. But I attacked the mat as if it was my first day of training. But that's that. I mean, as an athlete, that's how we've just always been trained, is 100% every single time. So that was instilled from, you know, as a child. So for me, it's to, you know, I don't care who's running the show. In my mind, I'm running the show. And as long as I continue to push myself and bring my very best performance every single week, it don't matter if, you know, if it's Vince, Triple H, Nick, Stephanie, Amazon, Disney, Paul Heyman, Jimmy, you could run the show and you know who the man is.
Oh, I'd have some good storylines for you. All right. Any initial thoughts just on how Paul Levesque, Triple H has done the first month here in charge with the shows? I know it's gotten a hugely positive feedback online. Just curious if you want to get into that.
I think he's done excellent. I mean, and you know, I think he's like a professional wrestling baby face right now. You know what I mean? The industry, he's like a baby face for the industry right now. And there's like this honeymoon situation going. There's a lot of excitement. But I mean, if you look at the grand scheme of it and like kind of just break it down of what he's stepped into, just dealing with this controversy alone. I mean, dealing with the craziness of like the impossible happened, like Vince McMahon stepped down, like just dealing, wrapping your brain around that and then being the guy to like be next, you know what I mean? Like, I thought following Cena was tough enough. I mean, imagine having to follow Vince McMahon, right? You know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
So and I think he's done great. I really do.
And the layer in this, I don't want you to comment on it, but I'm just going to throw it out because I think what's at the top of the mind of every single wrestling fan or anyone who just follows WWE and wrestling, Triple H is in charge, Stephanie's in charge, Vince is retired, but he's still their father-in-law and father. So like, it's hard for me to believe at, you know, on a Sunday dinner, Vince isn't like, you know what you should do with Roman? Have him do this, you know? So that's how my family would be. They don't stay out of anybody's business. So I'm sure, you know, I would love to know what those.
I mean, from a wrestling family, I can see that 100%. I mean, I could be sitting next to my dad right now and, you know, he'd be throwing out the same type of ideas or trying to pitch me something, you know, that's just the way it is.
Well, one thing that can't be denied, you talked about still working, is if you're trying to prove yourself and taking the bumps, what can't be denied is the reaction you generate. And I'm talking specifically recently about the Madison Square Garden show that was a Monday Night Raw. I mean, the crowd was kind of batshit that night when you came out. And I thought the way it all played out was tremendous, too, because there's nothing like live TV. And you guys probably hate when there's mistakes or something goes sort of, but the fact that the mic didn't work for Paul Heyman added another layer, I thought, to just the awesomeness of that whole thing. Now, I'm a New Yorker, so I'm biased. So I want to put myself out of this. I want you to tell me, is there really that something extra special about the Garden when you're in there?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Before you've ever been there the first time, there, it's the chatter, it's the talk, it's the buildup that everybody kind of puts this reputation on it. Then you get there and you go through the hassle of getting into it. So then it's like, man, I done went through all this. I better have an awesome night tonight and it better be special. But then when you get out there, it absolutely is. When you filled it up and it's incredible. But the energy, you know, it's that New York energy. Nobody sleeps.
Can you tell us, was it difficult to get the "your daddy's not here anymore" line approved?
Come on, approved.
Oh, are you?
Paul, what do you think about this? He said, "That's great." I said, "I approved. Perfect." That's our approval process.
You don't have to go to maybe someone at a top level to say, is this line cool?
No, because I'm responsible. And I've handled that responsibility for years now, and they trust me. And I'd never go out there and say anything that would affect our business. And you know, that's the key. And that's especially in the time that we're in right now with the guard shifting. It's key that Triple H can see that in a lot of these younger people. And you have seen those slip ups. You have seen those little live conundrums happen to people out there using words. And for me, if I'm Triple H or anyone running creative, I'm thinking, how can I trust these people with a live microphone? Because we can go out there and say whatever we want if we wanted to, but that'd be right. The last time we ever did it.
Right.
So for me, I've just had that responsibility and, I've taken care of it over the years.
What is that feeling like when you're standing in the middle of the ring in Madison Square Garden, there's 20,000 people, they're going crazy. You drop that line, your daddy's not here, and you get that. Everyone was like, oh, like when you get that, is that as good as it gets? Or is the physical stuff when you do, I don't know, a spear or something, is that, what's the bigger high? The reaction from a promo line or a reaction from a physical move, so to speak?
It's hard to like distinguish the like one greater than the other, but I think I think the feeling of cutting a promo and having them react accordingly or go ape shit for something you said, there's something that's crazy about that, because that'll get your heart going real. Like, I mean, you know, they go nuts for whatever you said, or they start chanting it, and then there's this crazy power you feel, and you can feel your heart, your heart elevate and your heart rate elevate and all that. It's hard to feel that sensation that's happening in that moment, because when you're wrestling, you're already amped up because you're sweating, your heart's going nuts, you're breathing hard. So you don't see that transition from being completely calm and still and not sweating at all with no, you know, crazy energy to saying something and then the crowd's going just nuts for you. And then all of a sudden, you know what I mean? Inside, your heart's going nuts, you feel crazy. So they both feel awesome, but there is something about controlling reactions with words.
I'm sure we got to wrap soon, but I got to ask you just one or two more quickly. And just to remind everyone, Roman will face Drew McIntyre, Clash at the Castle, Saturday, September 3rd, 1 o'clock Eastern, WWE Network, Peacock. One of the many reasons I love having you on this podcast, and I'm so grateful you come on and you're always a good sport, is I can ask you questions that I know I'm not going to get like an answer out of, but you'll give me something. So I'm going to do it again. We've done it before with this question, but we've got to do it. The Rock, WrestleMania, everyone thinks it's the dream match. It's in LA this year. When I had you on and asked you about it once before, you said, well, it's in Texas this year. Wouldn't it make more sense to do it in LA? And then I guess the show Young Rock on NBC dropped. They had a scene where you and Rock were younger, in your younger days as kids playing around. And in the show, The Rock says to the Roman Reigns, well, you're probably Joe back then, this is a match not for the kitchen, it's for WrestleMania or something. And that got people buzzing again. So can we get an update?
Update is Dwayne's dropping it within his own project. So it's got to be pretty good. It's got to be pretty special. I think that just goes to show the clamoring, you know, the buzz for it, the chatter for it. The wishful thinking. So it's something that he definitely played into, you know, within the Young Rock, which, as you know, with him, everything's highly strategical, a lot of synergy with everything that he does, with the projects that, that he's guiding and has in mind. So, I would say just based off of that alone, it looks even better than it did last time we spoke.
All right. We need it. There's nothing I don't think any wrestling fan wants more than Roman Reigns versus The Rock at WrestleMania. In doing a little research, you have mastered the art of creating t-shirts and merch off of sayings. You know, see, you laugh so quick. You know, I mean, the fact that we've got the Acknowledge Your Daddy t-shirt out right now.
Tribal
Chief shirts, Head of the Table, Greatness on a Different Level, Needle Mover, Wreck Everyone and Leave. Obviously, there's all the Acknowledge. you've mastered. Is that you, or is that you working in conjunction with the team? Or how much of that is you doing that? Because it's kind of brilliant that everything ends up that way.
So, I mean, it's always going to revert back to the team. I mean, you know, I'm definitely the strongest generator of these phrases, obviously. You know, nobody's written a phrase for me, but, you know, I've been out there literally cutting the promo. And as I'm walking back, someone like Bruce Pritchard's like, that's a shirt. And I've already, you know, I've already contacted merch and they're working on it. And they're going to shoot you some, you know, some prints so you can approve. So, I mean, as far as going through the creative process of coming up with this crap, I say, it's pretty much all me. Paul might jump in there every once in a while. Yeah. And then the creative process will go between me and the actual merch team. And you know, there are artists that that we work with to adjust all these little things to them.
Now, I'm going to put you on the spot here a little bit. I mentioned all the phrases and there's so many shirts. Are you aware of this, though? I mean, this is bad for a podcast, but I'm going to hold this up here.
Okay, bring it over just a little bit because it's where my face is.
There we go. Do we need, do we really need, now I don't know if you wear these, let me tell the audience, you were not aware? I'm breaking this news to you.
I'm not sure. Okay. But hey. So
for those listening and not watching on YouTube, there are a pair of, it says men's black Roman Reigns contenders boxer briefs. And right on the front of the boxer briefs are the words right over the crotch. Acknowledge me. And you're telling me you didn't know these were being sold.
You never know at .com. You know what I mean? That's the thing with this. So we have
now, can you imagine the awkwardness that this could present in certain situations?
No, Jimmy. That's when you drop them and there's no words needed. You know what I mean? I'm trying to
help. That's true.
Trying to help my people out, you know?
That's for the shy
strong men. And silent. Yeah. Strong and silent. Exactly. There it's for go. The shy guys. You know what they say about shy guys, right?
I love the fact that you didn't know those were being sold. That just made my whole day. I'm so happy that I broke that news to you. Before I let you go, just quickly, have you had anything with, you know, we've talked over a couple of times where you've almost broken a little bit because of Heyman. I think it was the Daniel Bryan ringing the bell I know there was a time when it wasn't you, it was Cena, when he did the Cena music, which was just so freaking hysterical. Have there been any incidents? I mean, when Heyman in Madison Square Garden, I was looking at you because I said, I want to see when the mic broke and he said, you'll be the next one out of here. I thought that was brilliant. Have there been anything with Paul lately where you've said, I'm almost going to break here. Let me.
Well, that one was good because, you know, like you said, we didn't plan. We never want the mic not to work properly for us. So as that was happening, he did pop me with that. But that's one of those moments where there's, you know, there's a little unfocus on the situation. So you can kind of smirk or smile. There was something a while ago. I don't know how long ago this was, but there was something with Jay. And I think Paul just kept rubbing, like it was a backstage we were doing. I may have yelled at Jay or something like that. And he stepped off to the side and Paul's just rubbing his back. And apparently he just kept rubbing it. And they're like about to crack up behind me as I'm finishing up the scene or whatever. Okay. So, I mean, it's just a good time. And Paul just chills with us. You would think, you know, Paul's a 35-year-old, you know, Polynesian man, just the way he fits in with us. And he, I mean, he's pretty much just become family, though he was before, because he's been with our family for so long. But just the time that we spent with him and just how close and how much admiration we have for him.
I said earlier, what wrestling fans want more than anything, WWE fans want more than anything, is the Rock versus Roman Reigns at WrestleMania. I know for me, if you ask me, like, what would be second on my list, it would be a Paul Heyman podcast. I mean, everyone in wrestling, it seems like on the back end of the careers when they're done, there's so many wrestlers. I mean, there will be nobody who has a better podcast ever than Paul Heyman when that it will happen. It's just, you know, when you guys maybe wrap it up, but he will have the best podcast ever, basically.
Oh, yeah. I mean, anything like that that he's ever going to step into, he's going with the mindset to be number one. And I'm sure if he hadn't already, he's setting all that up. He's very strategic and you know, making everything and giving himself as much of an advantage as possible. So I'm sure if that does happen, it's going to be huge.
Could you ever see yourself having a podcast? Even let's say it was a limited run when you retired and, you know, some Spotify comes to you, they go, Roman, we'll give you $1 million for 12 podcast episodes. Would you ever even consider it?
I think anything, all the different platforms of entertainment we have, I don't see why not. I mean, I talk for a living, so why wouldn't I want to just sit down and have a discussion? We do these type of interviews. I've done several podcasts. I just haven't been on the other side of them, obviously, either just BSing with, you know, my crew or interviewing people. But I mean, you throw me with my cousins, we're ready to go tomorrow. You know, it'd probably be just ridiculous and we'd either get canceled or just be people would really know that all these guys are idiots. You know, no wonder they're wrestlers and creative because they're just big kids. But I think anything that I can continue to connect with my fans and showcase different layers, I'm definitely interested in that.
Well, I appreciate you coming on as always. You're always fun to talk to. Like I said, we got Roman versus Drew McIntyre. Clash of the Castle, Saturday, September 3rd, 1 o'clock Eastern, WWE Network on Peacock. Enjoy your reduced schedule. We look forward to seeing you versus The Rock. And maybe you'll get a pair of the Acknowledge Me briefs now that you know they're out there.
I'm over here buying all the wrong underwear. I should just be rocking my own stuff. You
know? Seriously?
My wife would love that. Yeah.
Roman, it's a pleasure. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Be well.
Pleasure, Jimmy. Thanks for having me, man.
All right. Joining me now from The Athletic, he covers college football. He hosts the Andy Staples Show, former SI colleague of mine, with college football starting and TV rights deals going crazy. Great time to talk to Andy Staples. Andy, how are you?
I'm good, Jimmy. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. Thank you for coming on. Ready for college football?
Oh, cannot wait. It's the longest off season in sports and it feels longer every year. And I just on Saturday when Northwestern and Nebraska kick it off in Dublin, the game everybody's been waiting for, it will feel like we finally made it.
I'm looking forward to that game, but I cannot stand this week zero nonsense.
Well, they should week of games here. Let's just do this. Right. If people want to do two open dates during the season, do that.
Right,
because these games are not good. Now, I do feel like we need that. We need the appetizer because we're just not our systems aren't ready to process full uncut Notre Dame Ohio State quite yet.
So it's got to be called something better than Week Zero.
Oh, I like Week Zero. If especially if the games are going to stink, Week Zero is a good way to refer to it.
But if you're a better, they don't stink.
They're wonderful.
They're all good. They're all good.
Yeah.
Let's get into this Big Ten TV deal that came about because I have a take that I must be the only one with this take. So I wanted to gauge your opinion on it. It was obviously huge news. It was covered a ton, rightfully so. The money is huge. The Big Ten is off ESPN for the first time in 40 years. USC, UCLA going to the Big Ten, which makes this, you know, a little sexier for CBS, NBC. But for me, thinking about the college football viewer, just your average, typical man or woman who watches college football, I don't think this is as big a deal as it was made out to be, only because the games that are all on the way they were, they're just on different channels and different times. Like you're not getting anything more. You're not getting anything different.
Well, okay. It's not a big deal to you if you're not a psychotic college football fan, but if you are, like the fact that the CBS college football theme song,
right,
dun, 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 is going to play before a Big Ten game and not an SEC game. Like that's a big deal.
I agree that
I realize it's not in the grand scheme of things, a big deal, but that is something that people think about and care about. Whether that they should or not is another story, but it is something. And it's funny because I had a fan tweet at me the other day and said, "Does anybody actually care about this TV stuff?" And I'm like, "We look at the numbers. Like you read the crap out of this stuff,
right? Listen, people care. There's no doubt that people care. And I think you hit the nail on the head. I mean, I think it's, yes, the Big Ten going to CBS at 3:30, people care about that. The SEC is going to, but in terms of consuming the games, viewing the games.
Yeah, it won't change it. You will find the game you want to find, especially right. because what are we talking? We're talking about NBC, CBS, and Fox here. Like,
right.
Everybody got those channels. Like, right. nothing's going to be difficult. This would be probably a bigger story, and the learning curve would be different if they said, okay, half these games are going to be on Amazon Prime now, or half right. these games are going to be on Hulu. Right. Like that would be different. But this, yeah, I mean, anybody with rabbit ears is getting these games.
I thought that was the most significant thing outside of the money is this was a win for linear TV because, like you said, you're getting games now, Fox, CBS, NBC, Big Ten games. So, for instance, though, like that game that's on going to be on NBC at night at 7:30 or 8 o'clock, that was a game that used to be on like ESPN or Big Ten Network or FS1.
Well, here's the thing. Whether that NBC game outrates whatever SEC game is on ESPN at 8 p.m. is an open question because that's going to be probably the second best SEC game of the day.
Right.
And maybe the third best Big Ten game of the day. It may not be as good of a game. And so ESPN may right. still win that ratings battle, even though it's cable and the other one's over the air. But no, it's the bigger story is the off ESPN piece of it, because that's not something that people felt like they could do, that leagues felt like they could do as recently as 6 years ago. When the Big Ten did its last set of deals, Jim Delaney, who was the former Big Ten commissioner, did not like what he thought was ESPN's outsized influence on the game, going back to basically being mad at them lowballing him in the early 2000s for some of his games. So he would have done it earlier, but the thought was if you go off of ESPN, then ESPN stops talking about you and suddenly there's not much conversation around your games or they're not being promoted. Well, now we don't get our conversation starters from ESPN anymore. Like, we get it from social media. We get it from whatever podcast we listen to. We get it from a lot of different avenues. Like, nobody watches college football live. Nobody is just dying to hear it. Kirk Herbstreit's not the only person whose opinion counts on this stuff. And so if you're the Big Ten, you go, look, we're big enough. Like, you have to talk about Ohio State and Michigan if you're ESPN. And if you don't, who cares?
Yeah,
you got a lot of other places where they'll talk about
yeah.
it.
Yeah, I thought that part, that theme that ESPN would ignore the Big Ten, I think is completely overrated and not true from this. You know, a lot of people bring up the NHL. Well, when ESPN got out of the NHL business, they were out of the NHL business completely. Yes. ESPN's still in the college football business, so they can't Correct. Ignore the Big Ten. Now, for instance, Game Day has gone to sites where ESPN, you know, if a Notre Dame
I pointed this out. There's so many SEC on CBS games yeah. where Game Day has been there.
100%.
Like, they're not going to yeah. stop going to Big Ten sites
100%.
Because they're on a different channel.
Right. And NBC, Notre Dame games, they've been on that site yeah. for that. So, yeah, they can't. And ESPN still has the playoff. So mm-hmm. they're not going to ignore the Big Ten. If Ohio State and Michigan are in a playoff, ESPN's not ignoring that. So I thought that theme was overrated last week when that came out.
Yeah, and a lot of it is this is the Big Ten's prelude to, and Fox, which essentially controlled the Big Ten's media rights negotiations, to getting a piece of the playoff next time. They do not want the playoff to be owned by one single entity next right. time. And look, if you're one of the people selling the playoff, which would be all of the conferences, you also shouldn't want it to be owned by one single entity because you'll make more money the other way.
Right, right. I think what'll be interesting is, and it did see, I did feel like in the reporting last week of the Big Ten leaving ESPN and going to CBS and NBC, it's like everyone forgot that ESPN was getting the SEC game in 2 years at 3:30. Like, that's yeah. a huge get for them. I think the most interesting thing to come out of all this will be next season, the 2023 season, when if ESPN and CBS don't cut a deal to get that SEC game over to ESPN, maybe a year early. So in 2023, the 3:30 CBS game the 3:30 SEC game will still air on CBS. It'll be the last year. And they still have that Big Ten game where then ESPN will be at it. Next year is where it gets set up for something interesting. Do you think at all that there's a chance the CBS SEC 3:30 game that ends a year early and goes to ESPN in 2023 instead of 2024?
When they made that deal 4 years early for ESPN to get that package, I assumed that that was something that would happen, that there would be some sort of early exit. But now I'm not so sure. Like CBS, first of all, it's the best deal in sports. CBS pays $55 million a year for the best SEC game of the week. That's a package that's worth at least $300 million a year. Right. And so I think they're just going to squeeze, because that package leads the ratings almost every year. They're going to squeeze as much as they can out of that. I would if I were them. Like, because if you want to buy it away early, how much do you have to pay for that? You've got to pay CBS more than it's going to make off of it.
Right.
I don't know if that's financially feasible.
Yeah. ESPN has to hold out till.
There's also the spite factor from CBS and the SEC, not fans of one another, and haven't been for a while. And this dates back to when the SEC added Texas A&M and Missouri, renegotiated its deal with ESPN to create the SEC network, went to CBS and said, hey, we got some new inventory, new teams. How about let's redo that deal? And CBS was like, no, we're good. And that was that. They were essentially dead to one another at that point.
Right, right. That's interesting. Tell me, as a New Yorker, where you know college football is not a hotbed here, and you know I follow it mainly for the gambling purposes, but I know the big teams. I like the big teams. I get into it. I watch it every Saturday. The impact of USC and UCLA going to the Big Ten. Now, I personally, I don't understand the big attraction of UCLA. Like, they haven't been relevant since Troy Aikman. And there's this theme that, like, they're still relevant across America. I don't see that. USC, I think, is a little more relevant, but I don't think either of them are on the level of the Georgias, Ohio States, Michigan, Notre Dame, you know, maybe even Texas and, I don't know, Oklahoma. Give me, am I way off on that?
USC could be that relevant. If Lincoln Riley can make them good again, they can be on that same level and represent the West Coast as the power team on the West Coast. UCLA has never really been that. I mean, they have back in the 60s, but they're not that. But what they are is a pretty uniform, a pretty helmet, a school that every person in America knows. Everybody's heard of UCLA. Right. And so when you put that helmet next to Michigan State's helmet or Penn State's helmet, or Ohio State's helmet or Iowa's helmet and say, here's this game on CBS or NBC, guess what? People might watch it.
Yeah. I have a feeling that we're going to see a lot of USC UCLA games on the NBC package because it's later.
Agreed.
Third game. I think you'll get a heavy dose of that. Do you like covering the TV stuff, the media stuff?
Yeah, I always have. That's something I've always been interested in because I'm fascinated by how we consume media, how it's changing. I'm a gadget person, so I'm always looking for the new devices and I try out all the new streaming services when they come out. I don't keep them all. I don't necessarily stay subscribed to them all. And like I'm fascinated about when the tipping point will be. When will we be comfortable with a major sports league mostly on a streaming service? I know the soccer fans are going, well, no, I watch it on Peacock now. Right. But I'm talking about a major American sports league where their main way of seeing it is through a streaming service. Now, if Sunday Ticket's on Apple TV Plus, which sounds like that's what's going to happen, that will be the big that's probably the tipping point.
Right. Right. Do you like covering realignment?
I like covering it. I feel bad for the fans of the schools involved in it because it's got to be incredibly frustrating. I wrote about this the other day. Like, imagine you're an Oklahoma State fan or Kansas State fan or Washington State. You've done everything they say you're supposed to do, like invest in the program, hire a good coach, build a good facility, you know, develop your players, turn them into draft picks, win games. They've done everything. And then you're being told, no, because of where you are and the size of your alumni base, you can't be part of this. Like, that sucks. So I feel bad for those people. But the intrigue of realignment and covering all that, it's fascinating because it's super cloak and dagger. everybody wants to know what's going on. Nobody actually knows what's going on. Only a few people have solid information, and they do their damnedest to keep it a secret.
Do you like covering the media stuff? You like covering the realignment? Do you like covering NIL?
I like it just because you get funny things like DeColdis Crawford doing commercials for HVAC companies and Bijan Robinson with his own Dijon mustard. But readers hate reading those stories. I can tell you that right now. They don't read any of it. Yeah. They complain about how it's going to destroy the sport, but then they don't read the stories about it. And then they watch the games like they always have. But I've always been a person who said the players should get whatever they deserve.
Yeah.
This is America. You know, they should be able to make as much money. And I don't care if boosters pay them. I don't care if someone pays them to go to a particular school. Doesn't matter to me. It's a market. It'll find its level. And so I'm loving this. Like the fact that the people in charge of college sports fought against this for so long, and they look like such idiots because they could have been doing this all along, didn't have to get their clocks clean in the Supreme Court. The sport's not going to fall apart. In fact, it's making more money than ever. And oh, by the way, the players are getting paid.
Right. Yeah, I'm with you on all that. And I can't read any. And I'm a person just on Saturday, I want to sit down and watch the games. I don't care about the NILs, and I think the players should get paid. So I'm with you on that. The reason I asked the NIL question too is I don't know if harder is the right word, but I feel like it must be a little bit harder to cover college football these days with all this
much to write about.
That's a good way to look at it.
Change in the transfer rules.
Yeah.
Where people are moving to different teams. Like now, I will say preseason prognostication, preseason analysis, much more difficult because we don't know anything about these teams. So many of them have radically different rosters than they had last year. And so, but what I think that's going to do is create a fantastic, especially first few weeks of the season, as we figure out exactly what the hell is going on.
Right.
And I'm excited for that because we're going to get some results where we thought this team was going to be good and we thought this team was going to be bad. And they're going to do something that is completely counter to what we were thinking for the last 9 months. And we're like, holy crap. And then we try to solve that mystery as these teams give us more data. That part I'm so excited about. That's why I've been dying for these games because I just want to see what some of this looks like.
Yeah, for sure. I want to go back to the Big Ten thing because I meant to ask something and I forgot. Like I said, when I didn't consume the news maybe as much as everyone else, because once I saw that, you know, they weren't getting crazy with the streaming and you know, everything was, people can still watch. I didn't dig into like the deep ramifications of it, but I did see a lot of headlines that this may have a significant negative impact on college basketball. Can you just break that down for me and my listeners?
The reason they're saying that is, you know, it's interesting because ESPN basically built itself off of college basketball. It was very cheap, plentiful inventory in the early 80s. And that's a lot of what ESPN was buying up and showing. And, you know, it's sort of, if you are a casual college basketball, which there's not many of those people, there's not a casual college basketball fan is kind of an oxymoron because it doesn't really exist. But you would turn, let's say Tuesday night, you just turn on the TV and there'd be a Big Ten game on or an SEC game on or, you know, Big Monday in the Big 12. And so that part of it's gone now for the Big Ten. And those games are probably on FS1, at least from football ratings. FS1 tends to not be a stop on the dial that most people have in their head.
That's the degenerate gambler channel. Right,
yeah, there. It's not so like when you walk into a sports bar, you have to ask to get a TV on FS1. Yes. Like you don't, they don't automatically have it there. So,
and then it's 10 or 15 minute battle to figure out what channel it is.
Right. It will be weird. Like if there's a Michigan State Iowa basketball game on a weeknight and it's on FS1, there will be some frustration there from people because ESPN, despite that they're both basic cable channels, they're both very well distributed. I mean, FS1 is not as well distributed as ESPN. It's close. Almost everybody has it.
Mm-hmm.
But people don't reflexively go to it. So there's going to be some retraining there. And about 20% of those games are going to be on Peacock. Now, I'm of the mind that those are games that even ESPN considers of little value. They might have been BTN alternate games anyway.
Right.
Like, I'm not sure. Like, you weren't going to gather any casual fans who just stumbled upon that game anyway. Those are for the hardcores. And that's why I keep trying to tell people the math's different on that. Like, you only need like one out of every seven or eight who would have watched that game to subscribe to Peacock for the dollars and cents to work out for NBC on that deal.
Right, right. All right, since you like the TV stuff, we'll stick with that. Let's do a few things here. The Pac-12, they haven't been on DirecTV. I don't get them on Fios. Where does the Pac-12 stand with becoming a real network?
The Pac-12 network is probably not long for this world.
Right.
I mean, it has been an abject failure. They took a big risk in owning and operating it themselves. They could have partnered. It doesn't sound like ESPN ever really wanted to partner with them. Fox, I think they talked to about partnering. They probably talked to some other people. But the thing is, and this is where the SEC and the ACC with ESPN and the Big Ten with Fox, why their networks were much more successful, is there's so much leverage there. When they're trying to get the Big Ten network distributed, Fox can go to people, and this is back before Fox sold everything off. This is when they have all of the stuff. They can go, oh, wait, so you don't want to have BTN on this tier at this price? Okay, fine. I guess you don't want Fox News Channel then either. And all of a sudden, the tone of the conversation changes. And meanwhile, Disney could do the same thing. Oh, you don't want to distribute the SEC network at $1.30 a subscriber in the footprint? Okay, cool. How about we take the Disney Channel off and see what all the parents of young kids who subscribe to your system say?
Right.
And all of a sudden, different conversation. Pac-12 could never have that conversation with anybody. And that's why it's very hard to find that network. And that's where one of the things that got floated, and I don't know if this died on the vine, I couldn't figure out exactly how this would work, where the money would flow. But one of the things that was kicked around was essentially dissolving the Pac-12 network, selling those rights to ESPN, and the Pac-12 and ACC networks sort of share that channel. And
that would make sense.
And then that way you have
ACC during the day and
Pac-12. Right. And then you have the Pacific Northwest and the Bay Area and Phoenix and Salt Lake City and Denver, for, you know, fairly big metropolitan areas,
yeah,
where suddenly that's now an in footprint cable subscriber fee. So that jumps from, you know, 20 cents per sub to 95 cents per sub, and all that's real money.
That would make sense. And the ACC network, I know, is on DirecTV, and I know I get it on Fios. So
you get it. They're very well distributed. I think they had there was one big cable system in the Northeast that they were struggling with that they got carriage on. The SEC network has been completely distributed since it launched. Big Ten network has been very well distributed since its launch. So yeah, that would be a potential solution for the Pac-12. But again, I don't know where the money flows. I don't know how the ACC schools would feel about that. So we'll see what happens. But like that, the Pac-12 network, I would assume, is on its way out eventually in the next TV deal. The Longhorn network will get folded into the SEC network, and when Texas joins the SEC,
right?
And all, so a lot of the cable networks that drove the last round of realignment, a lot of that will be resolved once this all changes.
Right. It's pretty wild.
I know.
It's crazy. The Pac-12 thing is amazing, but they just haven't, no one's seen them in all these years. I wrote a column earlier this week about Fox rehiring Urban Meyer. Of course, you know, Twitter and the internet being what it is, there are a lot of dopes who misinterpret what I wrote. I don't think Urban Meyer should be canceled. If Fox wants to hire him, Fox can hire him. If he wants to work there, he can work there. We're allowed to say he has a credibility issue after last year with the Jaguars and all that stuff. What I found amusing about it, and what the theme of the column was, despite what people wanted to interpret it as, was that even Fox was so embarrassed they didn't want to announce this. There was no press release. They put it in their like weekly, this is what's upcoming in week one or week zero.
Yeah, he's in the commercial though. They've got that commercial that ran with preseason football.
That was this weekend.
Yeah, yeah. I saw that. Yeah. And was surprised by that, actually. It's going to be interesting because they're taking that show on the road. It's gonna be wherever the Big Noon kickoff game is right. on Saturdays. And anytime it's not in Columbus, the signs behind Urban Meyer are going to be filthy.
That's like true.
And I'm not sure. Cause like most ESPN execs I know, they're in on a lot of the jokes. Like you can tell they understand how this stuff works. With Fox and college football, it still feels like they're still fairly new at this. So I'm not sure if they quite understand what's going to happen. Like everything he says will be played for comedy on the internet.
Right. And I think that's why they hired him, because I think Fox more than any other network is we'll take any attention we can get, even if it's bad.
Well, then they do understand if that's the case.
Oh, I think that's absolutely the case.
I don't think he understands that, even if his bosses do. But because he's going to launch into some speech about accountability and we're going to be laughing our asses off. Right. And I'm not sure that's the intent. Right.
He probably thinks he's still a college football god. And like you said, you know, outside of Ohio and Florida is going to get.
Oh, not in Florida either.
Oh, he's still not considered.
He's not well liked.
Okay.
So
it's just Ohio.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you know, again, to me, it's a credibility thing. Forget the thing with the woman in the bar, because that's what got the most attention. Whatever.
That will continue to get the most attention.
But here's what didn't get enough coverage from my standpoint about that. He went to that bar after a Thursday night football game where he flew back to Ohio and the Jaguars flew back to Jacksonville. I asked three NFL players, about that. And they said completely and totally unheard of that a coach would ever do that.
But here's where I will pause on that one.
Yeah, yeah.
If you're a college head coach and you played a Thursday night game and it's a time when you're allowed to recruit, you would never go back with your team. You would hit the road recruiting immediately after that.
Right. He treated the NFL like college.
Would you wind up in that bar doing that? I don't know.
Right. Right. Well, I guess I shouldn't play like psychologist, but you could make the argument that maybe what happened in the bar happened because the Jaguars wasn't used to losing every single game. So that was,
I'm not going to psychoanalyze that one, but we can let that thing stand on its own. Yeah. And I just know that he's going to give some speeches the way that they, I mean, that's what they wanted from him before.
I'm so cynical. I think Fox will push him to give those speeches. So then people on the internet can go crazy and give it all the attention and, you know,
that will be very interesting. I don't view it that cynically, just because I don't think they care enough to think that deeply about it.
I think they'll do anything they can to get more attention than game day. That's just my opinion.
Well, they will get I think they've actually done a good job with that show, making it more nuts and bolts football. Because there's an audience that does not like that game day has gotten away from that.
Right.
And so I think they've done a good job sort of finding that market that was underserved. And I think there's a lot of people who prefer that show.
Right. Yeah, for sure. I don't know. To me, game day is such an institution, but listen, there's
new viewers. Game day is the most important show in the sport, but I don't know. See, I used to think game day and Inside the NBA were the two best production, you know, studio, not even, and game day is not a studio show, but that sort of show.
Right.
I actually think Good Morning Football has replaced game day in terms of irreverence. And I'm just having so much fun when I watch this.
Yep.
Game day, I think, and look, I'm not criticizing them because they found a formula that really worked. It was a great show, a dominant show. But for me, and maybe it's just because I've been watching it since I was in college, it feels a little too formulaic now. Like it feels like the same thing over and over. And I want something different every once in a while. So
it's a fair argument.
That's it. And maybe they are going to do something different, because like on my podcast next week, I have an interview with Jess Sims, who's the Peloton instructor, who's going to be doing stuff. And I know you can look at that very cynically, but I only know this because I do a lot of the workouts, I'm like, she's going to be awesome on that, just right. because I know who she is and how she operates.
And she does have a reporter back. I mean, she does.
No, she's a teacher.
But I thought she wasn't just a Peloton teacher.
Yeah,
I thought,
she's the in-arena host for the New York Liberty. Right. Yeah. Right. So she's, yeah.
Last thing. I assume you watched the Manti Te'o.
Yes.
Netflix. What was your overall impression?
So I don't know if we want to spoil the documentary or not, but
we can spoil it.
Okay. The revelation.
Let me just say this. Spoilers are coming, so stop listening if you don't want spoilers.
Exactly.
Okay, go ahead and spoil.
The revelation that Renaya Tuiasosopo, the person who perpetrated the hoax, is now Naya Tuiasosopo, and that Lene Kakua, the fake girlfriend, was essentially the person that teenage Renaya wished they could be. It makes so much more sense. It does not excuse, because listen, Tuiasosopo did this not only to Manti Te'o, but other people. Like, Naya goes through the evolution of Lene Kakua and how many different people this was done to. Mm-hmm. And so it doesn't excuse it, but it finally makes the story make sense. Because, like, I don't know about you, Jimmy, but when I'm working on a story, when I'm covering something, I'm always trying to figure out what everybody's motive is. Like, what is everybody's angle here?
Right.
That one I never could, like, I didn't think Manti Te'o was in on it. That didn't make any sense.
Great.
Like, did this person do it just to torture Manti Te'o? That would make sense if they'd known one another, if they'd been enemies or something like that, but they didn't know each other.
Right.
But now when you hear about this, and it's interesting, because if that had happened, if we'd have learned all this back then, I don't know that we would be taking it in the same way we take it now, because I think we've learned more about that situation too. But just understanding the motive behind it, it doesn't absolve anything, but it answered my biggest question.
Right. Well, and it's funny, but when you say, when there's a story, you think, what's the motive? And I think I do the same thing, and you try to play it out. But we've also now, on the opposite end, everything is a conspiracy. And, I don't want to completely simplify it, but I think a big part of it for Tuiasosopo was just, it all got out of hand. It got they got in too deep. And they just kept, sometimes it's not a big grand conspiracy.
And probably didn't have an understanding of what sort of big forces were at play on the other side of the phone.
Right.
And it's fascinating. And that's why I was glad they did the documentary, just to look back at that. And because I was texting with some of my coworkers about it. And one was saying, the Deadspin people were so worried about getting ESPN and the New York Times and SI and the mainstream media that they didn't do this and this. And I'm like, guys, you understand that was literally their job at Deadspin, is to get the mainstream media.
Well, one of those guys, Tim Burke, was on last week, and he explained it, and he talked about things he'd do different, and he really thought this was a media story.
I've known Tim for a long time.
Yeah.
If they had just left out the paragraph where they said a friend of Tuiasosopo's believes Manti Te'o's in on it, if they just leave that out, it's a perfect story.
Yeah, I agree.
But the speculating that Te'o was in on it, opening that door when you didn't have a factual basis to open that door, I think caused a problem too.
100%. And I agree with you. I'm not defending it, but even if they didn't put that paragraph in, I think the same amount of people would have thought he was in. I think a lot of people wanted to believe he was in on it.
I said the same thing too, because I think people want to believe the worst,
right?
Especially when it's Notre Dame. People hate Notre Dame. It's crazy. Because every time I write anything about Notre Dame, tweet anything about Notre Dame, say anything about Notre Dame, one of the first responses I'll get on social media is, why are you talking? Who cares about Notre Dame? I'm like, you do. Because the last time I wrote about Minnesota, tweeted about Minnesota, you didn't say anything. You just, why? Nobody cares about Minnesota. You didn't say that. Right. You care about Notre Dame. Otherwise, you wouldn't have even thought to respond to me.
It's like the Lakers and the Yankees and the Cowboys. Yeah. And I do think their relevance in terms of like actual Saturday afternoon football games is not what people think, but that's a whole separate issue. Give me, before I let you go, we've got the season coming up. Give me a sleeper team who people should keep an eye on that could do some damage. That
the one I just mentioned, Minnesota.
Minnesota.
The Gophers. Tanner Morgan reunited with offensive coordinator Kirk Ciarca. They had a really good year together in 2019. Tanner Morgan averaged like 10.2 yards an attempt. Was one of the most efficient quarterbacks in the country that year. And they got a running back named Mo Ibrahim, who last we saw him was tearing up Ohio State in the season opener, and he got hurt and was out for the rest of the season last year. So, yeah, the Gophers could be the best team in the Big Ten West this year, unless Wisconsin or Iowa wind up doing it.
All right. I will check out their over-under on FanDuel and
there you go.
And accordingly. Appreciate you coming on. It was good catching up and really great insight on the TV deals. Helped me and the listeners a lot. So I appreciate it. Enjoy the season. And I'm sure I'll get you back on here maybe in January when we get to playoff time.
Anytime, Jimmy. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Andy. Appreciate it. Take care. All right. My thanks to Roman Reigns and Andy Staples for joining me this week. Sal will be back next week for Train of Thoughts. Had to skip it this week. That was on me. But we'll see Sal next week. My thanks again to Roman Reigns, Andy Staples. If you missed any recent episodes, go into the archives, check them out. Leave a review on Apple. We will read it on the pod very shortly. All right, that wraps it up for this week. We'll see you next week right here on the SI Media Podcast. Stay safe and take care.